Good morning. This hearing will come to order. Before we begin, I would like to ask unanimous consent that Chairman Miller and Ranking Member Brown be allowed to sit at the dais, speaking on their bills, and ask questions. Hearing no objections, so ordered. I want to thank you all for joining us today to discuss legislation pending before the subcommittees. The 11 bills on the agenda address important issues for veterans and their families, including providing additional compensation benefits, honoring deceased veterans, and finding new ways to improving claims and appeals processing. I would like to focus my remarks on the bill I am proud of to have introduced, H.R. 4782, the Veterans Compensation Cost of Living Adjustment Act of 2016. I'd also like to thank my colleague, Ranking Member Titus, for being an original co-sponsor. H.R. 4782 would authorize a cost of living increase as of December 1st, 2016 for veterans and their families who receive VA disability compensation or other benefits. Veterans earn these benefits as a result of their service to our nation. They and their families depend on these payments to help make ends meet. The amount of the increase would be based on the Consumer Price Index, which is also used to determine the cost of living adjustment for Social Security beneficiaries. Last year, veterans and Social Security beneficiaries did not receive a COLA, but cost of living may go up this year. Therefore, it is absolutely essential that we pass H.R. 4782 to ensure that veterans' benefits keep up with the rate of inflation. With that said, I look forward to a productive and meaningful discussion on each of the 11 pieces of legislation before us today. I appreciate the work of my colleagues who introduced these bills, and I also want to express my gratitude to the witnesses for being here to discuss them with us. I will now yield to my colleague, Ranking Member Titus, for any opening statement she may have.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for holding this hearing today so we can discuss some of this important legislation that affects our veterans. I want to thank you also for including my bill, the Medal of Honor Legacy Act. We have heard estimates from the Arlington National Cemetery that they're going to be at capacity within 2 decades, so we need to have a plan for what we're going to do there at the cemetery, and we certainly need to include in that plan our Medal of Honor recipients. In the history of our country, we've awarded more than 3,400 Medal of Honors since the decoration's creation 155 years ago. 361 of these recipients are buried at Arlington, and there are 77 living recipients still with us today. So the purpose of this legislation would be to ensure that they have a place at Arlington for these very few, very special servicemen and women who have received this highest honor. We worked with the Army and the VSO and guiding our language, and we thank them for their help, and we've tried to redraft the bill so that it includes their suggestions. I understand, though, that they'd like to lower the number of places that we're going to set aside in the bill and to use this as an opportunity to plan future uses of Arlington. I think that's all fine, and planning is good, but I don't want that to become an excuse for not getting it done. Too often when we say we're going to do a study, that means we're going to put it on the shelf and we don't know when anything will happen, so we don't want that to be the case here. I also am very supportive of the bill that, or the policy to help veterans who have lost the use of a reproductive organ. These are veterans who have put everything on the line for the country, and now these IEDs have made the injury more prevalent, so we want to do all we can to help them start a family. I don't want us to do it kind of in a halfway manner, though. If we're going to do it, we should do it right, and we should do it so that it covers the problem and provides a benefit that really does make a difference and can be taken advantage of to address this challenge. Also, I'd just like to point out that since there's not a lot of discussion between the two sides prior to these legislative meetings, two issues that I hope that we will consider in the future, one that I've talked about for several years, and that's how to address the appeals process to get ahead of it so that we don't have the serious backlog problem that we have now with just the application for benefits. I know that the VSOs are working on this. The VA has said it's a priority. I hope that we'll have a real substantive hearing on some of the ways to address that legislatively. And finally, once again, and I will say this as long as I am here, I'm disappointed that the legislation I requested that we would consider today, H.R. 1598, which is the Veteran Spouses Equal Treatment Act, was not included. This is simply to bring the VA in line with the Supreme Court decision so that we recognize spouses of all genders, that we don't say a spouse has to be a member of the opposite sex. This is just outdated legislation or language in legislation that needs to be updated. Doesn't extend any kind of rights, doesn't impose on states' rights, doesn't say you support gay marriage. It simply brings the language up to date. So I hope that at some point, since there's bipartisan support for that, and the VA supports it, and VSOs have said they support it, that we'll consider that legislation. And with that, I yield back.
Thank you, Ms. Titus. Chairman Miller, I appreciate you taking time to be here today. You are now recognized to discuss your bills.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. It is a pleasure to be here. Ms. Titus, thank you for your hard work on this subcommittee as well. As members already know, our priorities must include ensuring that those who have been injured as a result of their service are fairly compensated for that injury, and that veterans who have passed on receive the honor and the respect that they deserve. My bill, which was noticed for this hearing as a draft bill entitled to amend Title 38 United States Code to pay special compensation to certain veterans with the loss or loss of use of creative organs, as introduced as H.R. 4892, would ensure that veterans who have suffered a traumatic injury to their creative organs would receive appropriate compensation for those injuries. In addition to regular compensation payments, VA provides a special monthly compensation, or SMC, to service disabled veterans due to circumstances such as the loss of a limb. For veterans who have suffered an anatomical loss or loss of use of a creative organ as a result of a service-connected disability, SMC currently pays approximately $100 a month. Although veterans appreciate this benefit, it does not adequately compensate the veteran for the unique nature of the injury that prevents the ability to have a family. According to the Department of Health and Human Services, private adoption fees can cost anywhere between $5,000 and $40,000. The bill would provide two separate special monthly compensation payments, or SMC payments, of $10,000 each. Veterans would be able to use this money however they see fit and to meet the needs of that veteran's specific circumstance. For example, a veteran could choose to use this benefit to defray adoption fees or to buy a house large enough to take care of foster children that they may bring into their home. However, a veteran may also choose to use these funds in other ways, as is typical for compensation payments. If a veteran does decide to use this benefit to raise a family, the real winner, in fact, is the children. Who better to teach our nation's children the important values like patriotism and service than the men and women who have served in the armed forces? As we consider proposals that would provide fair compensation for our wounded warriors, it's also important to ensure that veterans who have passed away receive the deference and respect that they're due. But before I discuss my other bills that are on today's agenda, I want to comment on VA's opposition to the important legislation that I just described. According to testimony, VA opposes my bill because it would create an inequitable benefit favoring some veterans over others. Really? Further, VA argues that the benefit would add an undue level of complexity to the claims process. Mr. Chairman, I am stunned at best. Once again, we have a situation where VA is more inclined to support the status quo than to address a real-world issue, the inability to start a family because of a service-related injury. Further, to argue this would add a level of complexity to the claims process is offensive to me. As VA testifies, these individuals already get a very minimal amount of compensation for a creative organ loss. Would it really be that difficult to identify and provide a meaningful benefit to those who've lost the biological ability to start a family? What I'd ask today is that the department go back to the drawing board and reconsider its position on this particular piece of legislation. Mr. Chairman, I've also introduced three other pieces that help our nation to better honor the deceased men and women who have sacrificed so much in defense of our freedom. One bill, H.R. 4757, would authorize the VA to furnish a special headstone or medallion to adorn the graves of those who were awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor and who are buried in a private cemetery. Currently, VA does not have the authority to do so if the veteran passed away prior to 1990 and is buried at a private cemetery in a marked grave. H.R. 4757 would allow Medal of Honor recipients, some of our nation's most treasured veterans, to receive the recognition they deserved by providing a government headstone, marker, and medallion for privately buried Medal of Honor recipients who served on or after April 6th of 1917. This ensures that as a nation we are appropriately honoring those veterans regardless of where they are laid to rest. I've also introduced H.R. 4758, which would authorize the issuance of the Presidential Memorial Certificate to deceased members of the Reserve or Reserve Officers Training Corps who are eligible for burial in a national cemetery. A Presidential Memorial Certificate is signed by the President and expresses the country's gratitude for that individual's service. I hope that the families who receive this certificate will understand how appreciative we as a nation are for their loved one's service and their sacrifice. And finally, I authored H.R. 4759, which would authorize VA to pay the burial transportation costs to state or tribal veteran cemeteries. Currently, the law only allows transportation costs to a national veteran cemetery. This bill will ensure that families are not financially penalized if they choose to have the veteran buried in a state or a tribal cemetery. And I would ask all of my colleagues to support this legislation when it comes up for a vote, and I yield back my time.
Thank you, Chairman Miller. Ranking Member Brown, thanks for joining us. You are now recognized to discuss your bills.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, for this opportunity to speak on behalf of the important bills under consideration today. I am particularly pleased that we will be considering the bill H.R. 3715, the Final Farewell Act, that is of great importance to my constituents. While VA has the authority to provide weekend services to veterans and their families, they rarely do. This has been a particular challenge for various religion and cultures who bury their loved ones on Saturdays. Just 2 weeks ago, I attended a funeral service on a Saturday, then had to wait along with the family until Monday to bury the loved one because the cemetery would not bury the service members on Saturdays. This compounds stress from losing a loved one and being forced to break with tradition is unnecessary. My legislation, the Final Farewell Act, will make it easier for families with religion and cultural traditions to bury their loved ones at a time that works for the family. And I'm going to include some additional language there because I want to make it clear it's not just a cultural, it is also a serious financial burden to have to leave the bodies over to Monday. It is an additional cost that the families have to incur. Our veterans deserve to have their common sense convenience. Thank you for considering H.R. 3715 and the support of this common sense change. Another bill I'm very proud to have introduced is the Loved One Lives on Act. And there are 10 surviving spouses in the audience. Can you just stand up? So if it's 10 here, you know it's thousands in the community. Thank you all for being here today. I had the opportunity to host our surviving spouse at a roundtable last November. I heard them loud and clear, following the United Kingdom's lead and eliminating the age restriction on remarrying. What many may not know is that our current law is discouraging widows, spouses of our most valiant servicemen from remarrying. The UK noted that many of these spouses are in committed relationship but refrain from marrying to retain their income. The right thing to do is clear, and I hope to have my colleagues' support on this matter. Lastly, I would like to voice serious concerns for the legislation proposed from Chairman Miller that would pay two lump sums payments of $10,000 for those who lose their use of a creative organ. This legislation is trying to address a health issue by offering cash instead of needed timely treatment, and I strongly oppose it. I believe a better alternative and compromise is the language that's been agreed to in the bipartisan manner in the agreement struck by the Senate to provide these veterans with health care. This language is very similar to language proposed last year by Chairman Miller, and in concept, I support that. Being able to have a family is an important step toward healing our veterans and their families. I am committed to find a way to make this happen. And I want to mention one last thing as I close. This committee passed a bill a long time ago, but it's important to have institutional memory, that we forbid fertility treatment for veterans, female veterans. And I think we need to take a look at that, and this is something that we need to rescind, because this should be an option for those veterans that want this additional service. And the reason why we did it is because sometimes this treatment abort because of something is wrong with the service member. So we need to take a look at what we've done from this committee standpoint. I want to thank you for bringing these bills up, and I'm looking forward to working with them as it goes to the floor. I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Ranking Member Brown. Are there any other members that would like to speak about their bills? Representative Costello.
Mr. Chairman, thank you for including my legislation today and for the opportunity to speak in support of H.R. 3936, the Veteran Engagement Team Act, also known as the VET Act. This legislation would offer a solution for the veteran who needs assistance navigating the VA claims process. That solution, bring professionals into the community for our veterans to talk face-to-face with a real person who can offer them help in real time. Many veterans unfortunately struggle to navigate the VA's bureaucracy to submit their disability claims and receive the benefits they are due. To further complicate the process, our veterans are often subject to preventable delays that plague our current system: lost paperwork, a lack of communication, and an extensive claims backlog. This past summer, a Vietnam veteran asked my office for assistance with the VA and his disability claim. He initially applied for disability benefits years ago based on medical conditions he believed were service-connected, but his request was declined. Several months later, he reapplied. While he was ultimately approved for some benefits, the process took well over a year. Soon after, in March 2015, the veteran applied for an increased disability rating due to diabetic neuropathy, PTSD, and Parkinson's, and again in June 2015 for cancer. After contacting my office, my staff discovered that the VA facility incorrectly listed the veteran as having filed a cancer claim in March 2015. The VA then informed him they could not process the July claim as they already had one from the spring. However, this veteran was only diagnosed with the cancer in June, proving the claim was grossly misfiled by the VA. Thankfully, my office was able to resolve the situation and prevent a further delay of the veteran's benefit. Sadly, stories like this have become far too common for our veterans. They submit their disability claims to never hear of them again while they sit idle in a box for months or even years, and sometimes having been misfiled. Clearly, there is a claims processing problem. In an effort to ensure our veterans' claims are timely processed and do not suffer as a result of a growing claims backlog, I introduced the VET Act, a 3-year pilot program that streamlines the process by creating a one-stop shop for veterans. The legislation will bring VA employees into the community, providing veterans with direct access to physicians, claims raters, and other personnel to facilitate the completion and adjudication of claims. And if the request is not completed during the allotted time period, the VA is required to give the veteran a clear explanation of the next steps necessary to complete the claim. That last piece, I think, is a frustration for many veterans, not knowing or having that clear explanation of what they must do next in order to fully have the claim processed, completed so that it can be processed, excuse me. The VET Act will undoubtedly reduce wait times, miscommunication, and lost paperwork that plague the system today. In addition, this method has been tested and proven successful by the American Legion's Veterans Benefits Centers, as well as the VA's Claims Clinic at 2 regional offices. H.R. 3936 will continue upon the success and ensure veterans across the nation are receiving this one-on-one assistance in their communities. Importantly, this would be a major step in restoring the trust that for many has been broken between the VA and veterans they serve. I would encourage all my colleagues, Mr. Chairman, to support this bill, and I yield back the remainder of my time.
Thank you, Mr. Costello. Nobody else? Okay. All right. It's an honor then to be joined by our colleagues, Ms. Love from Utah, at the witness table today. Thanks for being here. You've got a proposal bill, H.R. 4087, the Fair Treatment for Families of Veterans Act. You're now recognized, Ms. Love.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Ranking Member Titus, and thank you, Ranking Member Brown, and the committee for granting me the opportunity to appear today. I am here today to speak on behalf of H.R. 4087, the Fair Treatment for Families of Veterans Act. This bipartisan legislation currently has 66 co-sponsors, including 4 members of the House Committee on Veteran Affairs. It has garnered the support from both sides of the aisle because while it is simple and straightforward, it is extremely important to veterans and their families. Presently, federal law stipulates that recipients of VA benefits are not entitled to compensation, dependency, or indemnity for compensation or pension benefits for the month of their death. Instead, the effective date of reduction or discontinuance of these benefits is the last day of the month before a marriage, remarriage, or death occurs. This can be problematic for families of beneficiaries who may unexpectedly be required to pay living expenses for the last month of a loved one's life. Compounding the problem, there are instances in which the VA has paid benefits in arrears for the months during which an individual died, only to require that those benefits be repaid after the payment has been made. Unfortunately, those benefits have frequently already been used for necessary living expenses. I know of several families of deceased benefit recipients that are required to pay back benefits that were already used. One family in my district received a letter 6 months after a relative's death requiring them to repay money that has already been paid to them and for the relative's care. A Texas family received a letter asking them to pay back money that had been received and used for 7 months for care 7 months earlier. Families like these have had to take money out of their personal accounts, sometimes retirement saving accounts, to cover unexpected costs. This has added stress and financial hardships to what has already been a challenging situation for them. The Fair Treatment for Family of Veterans Act would help families avoid this problem by changing the date of benefit reduction or discontinuance. The effective date would be adjusted from the last day of the month before to the last day of the month during which the death, marriage, or remarriage of the beneficiary occurs. In other words, these beneficiaries would be entitled to monthly benefits until they die instead of until the month before their death. This way, veterans and their families will experience greater peace of mind and avoid unexpected burdensome expenses. Our veterans and the families that support them deserve some degree of financial certainty in the exchange for the sacrifices they have made for our nation. I believe that this is the right thing to do, and I encourage the committee to enthusiastically support this important bipartisan piece of legislation. Thank you.
Thank you for bringing this bill forward and speaking at today's subcommittee hearing. We will forego a round of questioning for Ms. Love, and any question that any one of us may have may be submitted for the record. Now I invite our second panel to the table. Thank you for being here. We're joined by David McClinican, the Deputy Undersecretary for Disability Assistance of the Veterans Benefits Administration. He is accompanied by Mr. Matt Sullivan, the Deputy Undersecretary of Finance and Planning and CFO of the National Cemetery Administration. Mr. Patrick Hallinan, the Executive Director of the Army National Military Cemeteries. In his role, Mr. Hallinan is charged with overseeing Arlington National Cemetery. Thanks for all being here. Mr. McClinican, it's good to see you again, and you are now recognized for 5 minutes.
Committee, thank you for the opportunity to present the views of the Department of Veterans Affairs on several bills that are pending before the subcommittee. Joining me today is Mr. Matthew Sullivan, Deputy Undersecretary for Finance and Planning for the National Cemetery Administration. Mr. Chairman, VA supports H.R. 4782, the Veterans Compensation Cost of Living Adjustment Act of 2016. This draft bill would express the nation's gratitude to service-disabled veterans and their surviving spouses and children, and would ensure that the value of their benefits keep pace with inflation. VA also supports the general intent of H.R. 4757 to identify the grave sites of Medal of Honor recipients buried in private cemeteries. However, the extraordinary service that the Medal of Honor represents should be memorialized for all recipients, regardless of their date of death or burial location. We would be happy to work with the subcommittee to amend the bill to authorize a separate and distinct marker for the gravesite of any Medal of Honor recipient. Although VA supports the proposal in H.R. 4758 to expand the eligibility for presidential memorial certificates, we strongly recommend amending the bill to allow issuance of certificates regardless of the date of death of the individuals and to allow VA to provide eligible next of kin, relatives, or friends of reservists and retirees with a meaningful symbol of remembrance. VA supports the concept contained in H.R. 4759, subject to the availability of funds. We especially support expanding the transportation allowance to state and tribal cemeteries for the unclaimed remains of veterans who die without next of kin, as there are no costs associated with this expansion, and it would ensure the availability of a dignified burial option for these veterans. VA has concerns with several of the bills that remain. For example, VA does not support H.R. 3715, which would require VA to permit interments, funerals, memorial services, and ceremonies at national cemeteries during most weekends if requested for religious or cultural reasons. This draft bill would inadvertently disrupt VA's current flexibility to accommodate these very requests. VA already conducts committal services and interments on weekend days on a case-by-case basis. VA does not support H.R. 3936 for the reason being that we are currently piloting a program that's similar to the events described in this bill. These claims clinics, while successful for some of the participating veterans, have not reduced the overall processing time for veterans' claims. We have determined that event-oriented processing is more costly and resource-intensive than VA's traditional claim processing. VA likewise does not support H.R. 4087, which would adjust the effective date of reductions and discontinuances of VA benefits due to marriage, remarriage, or death. This amendment is ambiguous, would significantly increase VA's accrued benefits caseload, and increase mandatory benefit expenditures resulting from an additional month of entitlement after a beneficiary's death. And it might also complicate VA and the Department of Treasury's efforts to meet the requirements of the Improper Payments Elimination and Recovery Improvement Act. VA cannot support the draft bill to pay lump sum special monthly compensation to veterans with service-connected loss or loss of use of creative organs because the compensation program already provides additional compensation for these veterans. The lump sum payments would also be a departure from VA's long-standing monthly benefit payment structure and inequitable for veterans with other severe disabilities. Although VA appreciates the intent of the bill to improve consideration of evidence by the Board of Veterans Appeals, which is to expedite appeal processing, we cannot support it as written. The fiscal year 2017 President's budget observed that improvements to the timeliness of appeals processing should be achieved through comprehensive reform of the process that is in current law. However, this bill seeks to address a single step in the current multi-step process while not addressing significant defects in the overall statutory framework that currently precludes efficiency in the process as a whole. Finally, Mr. Chairman, VA cannot support the draft bill that would modify the definition of surviving spouse to permit entitlements to VA benefits when a surviving spouse of a veteran remarries. The draft bill is overly broad, would be very costly, and would overburden VA's survivor benefit programs. However, VA does not oppose amending or appealing the obsolete provisions in Section 5120. Mr. Chairman, this concludes my statement. We are happy to entertain any questions that you or the committee may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McClanahan. Mr. Holloman, and you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Chairman Abraham, Ranking Member Titus, and distinguished members of the subcommittee, thank you for this opportunity to provide the Department of the Army's views on the Medal of Honor Legacy Act. Arlington National Cemetery is unique and an iconic place devoted to those individuals who have made a significant life commitment of service to the defense of our nation and the armed forces. Arlington Cemetery was originally established as a national cemetery for soldiers who die in service of the country. Eligibility has changed through time, but always honored individuals who made a significant life commitment of service. These heroes served in every war or conflict since the founding of our nation. Arlington National Cemetery maintains the honor and dignity of each graveside service while hosting approximately 4 million guests annually. This duality of purpose brings the sacrifice of those buried at Arlington Cemetery closer to the American people. On behalf of the cemetery, the Department of the Army, I express our appreciation for the support Congress has provided us over the years. In May of 1864, Arlington National Cemetery was established as one of the first of 12 national cemeteries as a place to inter soldiers who die in service of the country. Eligibility has significantly expanded over time to include all former members of the armed forces whose last period of service terminated honorably, as well as their eligible dependents. The proposed Medal of Honor Legacy Act legislation as drafted would direct the Secretary of the Army to reserve a certain number of burial plots at Arlington National Cemetery for individuals who have been awarded the Medal of Honor and for other purposes. The Army understands the intent of the proposed legislation is to honor the recipients of the Medal of Honor. However, the legislation as drafted does not address the broader concerns of eligibility to preserve the life of the cemetery well into the future. This bill would reestablish gravesite reservations that were eliminated by Congress in December of 2010. Reservation of gravesites for one specific group would ultimately exclude persons who went above and beyond their service to our nation, including those who pay the ultimate sacrifice and die in defense of the nation. Currently, there are a total of 3,497 Medal of Honor recipients from all conflicts. 77 of those are living recipients. At present, there are 409 Medal of Honor recipients interred throughout the more than 70 sections of Arlington National Cemetery. Burial decisions are ultimately the personal preference of the deceased and their family. We should not assume they will all choose interment at Arlington National Cemetery. Based on past history, we are confident that if asked, most living recipients would prefer to be buried among the comrades with whom they served. The present rate of interment and inurement, coupled with the current inventory of available grave sites and niches, which includes the nearly complete Millennium Project but does not include the unfunded Southern Expansion Project, indicates that Arlington National Cemetery will run out of space for first interments or inurements in the mid-2030s. The impact of this legislation may result in an unavailability of grave sites for future service members killed in action. The Army understands the general intent of the legislation. However, the bill does not address the broader question of how long does our nation want Arlington National Cemetery to remain open and an active cemetery. The ability to redefine eligibility with the possibility of extending beyond our current borders to gain more contiguous space will allow the Army to ensure the cemetery remains available for first interments for our nation's heroes well into the future. We must take a holistic approach to solve this issue, which will require extensive coordination with the military services, our National Veterans Service Organizations, the Advisory Committee on Arlington National Cemetery, and the Congress. Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Titus, this concludes my testimony. I will gladly respond to any questions that you or the subcommittee may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hallinan. I'll begin the question, and Mr. McClanahan, even though there was no COLA last year across the federal government, please explain why it's important for Congress to pass the American Heroes COLA Act of 2016.
Mr. Chairman, one of the things that we really have to prevent, both working together, VA and the Congress, is to prevent our benefits from losing the value that they have to veterans and survivors. And that's really the key point for your bill, which is making sure that they have that value and continue to increase with the cost of living generally.
Okay.
It's a very important bill.
Back to you, Mr. McClanahan. As you know, SMC was originally devised to provide some additional compensation to veterans who had suffered the actual loss of limbs in service. Since its inception in the 1930s, however, SMC has evolved to meet the changing needs of the veterans. For example, SMCT was created because the VA's special monthly compensation program did not adequately address the needs of the veterans who experienced a severe traumatic brain injury. For most veterans who receive SMC, VA provides health care such as expensive prosthetics at no cost to the veteran. And since the VA does not provide adoption services, this bill would instead authorize two lump sums to defray the cost of adoption services if the veteran so chooses. Therefore, we are not creating a separate category for veterans. Rather, we are responding to the unique needs of the veterans who rely on the VA for their care. So I guess the question is, why is VA opposed to assisting veterans who have suffered a catastrophic injury to their creative organs?
Yes. Thank you for the opportunity to explain our position. We're very sympathetic to the needs of the severely disabled veterans. And in fact, as I looked at the data before the hearing, over the last three fiscal years, we've granted compensation for about 105,000 veterans for this very disability. It's our position that Congress got it right when Congress categorized certain severe disabilities in Section 1114K. It's our position that all those veterans who have those type of disabilities should be treated the same. And that's our main opposition to this particular bill. I understand the concerns regarding, in this particular instance, individuals who have lost the use or lost creative organs due to service connection. There's other individuals that are in that category that are also severely disabled. For example, a veteran who has completely lost ability to speak. It's VA's position that all these veterans with these severe disabilities should be treated the same.
And we'll have some follow-ups on that, if that's sure. Okay. Mr. Sullivan, how would you allow VA to pay the cost of transporting deceased veterans to state or tribal cemeteries to help veterans receive a dignified and proper burial?
Mr. Chairman, they would be eligible to apply for the transportation allowance that those that are eligible right now to apply for to our national cemeteries. So it would be a similar process.
Okay. Mr. McClanahan, one last question. You raised a technical concern with H.R. 4087 within your written testimony, particularly the potential for survivors to receive both the full amount of the veteran's compensation for the month in which he or she died, as well as a DIC benefit for that same month. If an amendment were adopted which specified that a survivor could only receive either compensation benefits for the month of the veteran's death or DIC benefits for that month, would the department be more receptive to that legislation?
Well, that would be a step in the right direction to clarify some of the ambiguity that we identified in the bill. So that would be one correction that would be helpful. I don't think that goes far enough. I think there'd be other corrections that would be necessary. For example, under the bill, VA would still be required to pay a month of additional benefits to others. Those payments could go to anybody other than the spouse. So the heirs could even escheat to a state. It could be passed on to others through the estate of the veteran. So we still have a lot of concerns about that bill.
Okay, thank you. I now recognize Ranking Member Titus for any questions she may have.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I would just ask Mr. McClinican, you mentioned that this is a very important bill that we bring the benefits up to the current rate, considering the increase in the CPI. I've been sponsoring or co-sponsoring this measure for years now, and if it's so great that we do it for 1 year, wouldn't it be greater if we just did it for every year automatically like we do Social Security, so that we don't have to come back and deal with the vagaries of politics in Congress every year?
I know that idea has come up in the past, and I know the department has taken a position on it in the past. Although it's not before us here today, I'm sure we'd be happy to provide you our views on that if you ask for them.
Okay. You can't just tell me off the top of your head if this is great, that wouldn't be greater?
Well, one difficulty that we have with the way that the law is structured now is we come before you every year to discuss the new COLA bill for this fiscal year. Certainly, we would avoid that problem if there was legislation that was entered. Yeah. Whether the department would support that particular bill is something that we'd have to get back to you on.
All right, thank you. Mr. Hallinan, you mentioned that the bill that sets aside a certain number of plots for our Medal of Honor recipients does not address the whole problem of how we plan what's going to happen to the cemetery over the next, century. So let me ask you this. How long do you think it would take you to do a study of what we need, how we need to address the fact that the cemetery is going to be full, or how we expand it, or how we have equal eligibility, or how all the services and all the wards are included? How long will it take you to do that study, and why don't you get busy doing it now?
And it's a great question, and I appreciate the opportunity. You're looking at how long can we maintain full operational integrity of Arlington National Cemetery well beyond 2050. We've met with some of the national VSOs organizations. Our advisory committee that reports to the Secretary of the Army has been tasked with this issue. So we are actively working the issue. But to answer your question directly, I would estimate approximately 4 to 5 months we should be able to come back with a report to this committee as to what we would think would be good recommendations to extend the life of Arlington National Cemetery.
Great. Well, that's shorter than I figured. But in the meantime, are you opposed to setting aside any plots for Medal of Honor winners, or just the fact that there's too many plots set aside in this legislation? If we reduced it to, say, 100, would that still be a problem for you?
It would not be a problem if there were 100 based on the amount that have been interred to date, the 409. We have 95,000 plots available at Arlington National Cemetery right now. I believe we would have to report back to the subcommittee and back to Congress in time to avert any potential problems down the road in the future. My concern is with the actual reservation process. Since Congress did away with reservations, there was a concern about do you reserve a certain section. The feeling is among a Medal of Honor recipients, most times they want to be buried among comrades, or even if they have family members interred at Arlington National Cemetery previously, how do you accommodate their wishes? And our goal being always to work with the families and accommodate their wishes. So we would not have a problem with 100. The bigger issue for us is, as you pointed out, is the concern about what happens after 2030. Because the Southern expansion is unfunded. If the Southern expansion were funded and we were to implement operations that would take us to the 2050s to be an open and active cemetery, and I think it's incumbent on us. We have the responsibility and duty to say, does the American people want the cemetery, Arlington, to close the first interments after 2050 or 2030?
Okay, that's enough. That's enough. I'm just saying, out of 95,000, looks like 100 is not too many to set aside for our Medal of Honor winners. So, I mean, despite all this study and all these statistics and all this, whatever it is you're talking about. I don't think that's too many. But, okay, will you get back to us with that study in 4 or 5 months? On the record, that's what you think it's going to take.
Yes.
We appreciate that. I'd like to go back then to Mr. McClenican. You are opposed to, as I am, the proposal put forth by Chairman Miller with the lump sum, even though I am very supportive of the notion of helping our veterans who have lost the ability to have a family. Are you more supportive of the proposal that's been put forth in the Senate that considers this more as a health care issue than a lump sum that can be used for these various purposes that the chairman now is supporting, even though originally he was more in line with the Senate bill?
I'm not familiar with the, and I don't know whether the department has offered a position on the health care bill that's for the Senate. Our main objection, as I mentioned, was basically equity for severely disabled veterans. You know, a second piece of that is the bill would have us provide these lump sum benefit payments to this subset of these severely disabled veterans. VA generally pays benefits on a monthly basis for compensation. So it would be a significant change for us to have to start paying lump sum benefit payments and administering a completely different payment process for veterans.
I don't believe that Senate bill includes that, so maybe it'd be more in line with what you support. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Titus. Mr. Costello, 5 minutes. Questions?
Yes, thank you. Mr. McClenican. Good morning.
Good morning.
In reviewing your testimony, and all my questions will relate to H.R. 3936, a couple questions. How much does a claims clinic cost, or how much, to use the term, those event-based team concepts, which I guess we'll call claims clinics, how much does one cost?
What I'd like to do is get back to you when we're done with wrapping up our analysis of the pilot that we've done, which we started in 2012. That's a very good question because our position is that really we don't get the bang for the buck out of the claims clinics. We can serve veterans better, we think, through the processing that we currently do. I don't want to really say too much more than that as far as the cost because we haven't fully analyzed the results of the pilot that we've been doing.
When do you expect that you'll issue analytical documentation on that pilot program?
I believe that's expected to be wrapped up next month, so we could get back to you.
So the work product will be issued in a month or your...
The work product. The analysis of the pilot that we conducted since 2012.
Will be forthcoming in the next month or two.
Yes.
So you've done sort of a comparative analysis, at least, I don't want to say philosophically, but I know you don't want to commit to numbers. How do you know what the number of claims that can be processed per work hour by an employee? In other words, you're comparing it to what is in place right now. How do you know whether what's in place right now is working and as efficient as it should be? And I'll ask a follow-up after.
Well, I think, as you know, we've done a lot of work over the past few years to become more efficient in how we process claims. I think, you know, the idea of the claims clinic, or such as what's suggested in your bill,
right,
you know, it was first raised back in a time when we had a very significant backlog of disability claims that we were working. We've made a lot of progress over the past few years. And so we're at the point now where the question is, do we devote resources to that type of veteran engagement scenario, which is important. And we're not denying that that type of engagement with veterans is very important. I think our secretary has made it clear with setting up his, you know, Veterans Experience Office in VA that's a very important role for the department. So we have to just find some balance between the resources required to do a claims clinic and the resources required to make sure we timely provide benefits to all veterans. And I think that's the balance we're looking for.
And it seems to me another consideration there is also whether a claims clinic ends up resulting in a lower likelihood of appealing that decision. And so will your analysis or what we see forthcoming look at that aspect, because one of the frustrations is that you file a claim, it's processed, it's incomplete, and you get bounced back and forth, so you're there for a long, long time. Whereas with the claims clinic, at least in theory, and I'm curious to see how it works in practice, is by virtue of having everyone there available, you get a much more comprehensive, immediate evaluation so that you know what's needed and it's right there. And if it's not there, then there's a clear explanation on what is needed in order to ultimately file a complete claim so that it's not remanded or it's not bouncing around. And I think even more frustrating is when a claim is filed and you don't know until 9 months later or some arbitrary period of time that it's incomplete. I mean, that's maddening. I'm not pointing the finger at you specifically, but so within the analysis of what it costs, it seems to me that the ability to file a fully complete claim up front, even if it's more time consuming for staff or more staff needs to be allocated to that versus the traditional way of claims processing, may over a period of years actually be more efficient. That's a hypothesis. And so I hope that what you do provide provides some substantive analysis on that point.
I think it's a really good point. If we can check to see whether, I guess you would call it, our customer service really aids in satisfaction for the veteran when they're going through the claims process. So I'll go back and check and see if that's an element that we're looking at in the analysis.
My final point, I know I'm running out of time. Oh, I am out of time.
Go ahead, sir.
The VA press releases relative to the claims clinics indicate that they were a, quote, great success and that, quote, attendance has greatly increased. And so what I glean or gather from that is that they are successful and that they do help individual veterans. Your testimony seems to suggest, and so I'm asking for you to sort of provide some commentary. Your analysis seems to suggest that it is not the preferred method, or at least you have some concerns about seeing this take seeing it expanded. So I'm asking you to reconcile that, what I view as a little bit of a disparity.
Without a doubt, I think the veterans that have participated in the claims clinics found it to be a good experience. So we're not denying that. I think the question is, though, how much resources do you put into something that provides a few veterans a better experience versus processing claims in a timely manner for all veterans? And that's the balance I was mentioning is, so I don't think the department's taking the position that there shouldn't be any claims clinics or that your bill's a bad idea. It's just doing the analysis to figure out, well, what's the best use of the resources that we have that have been given to us, and then determining what's the future of these type of engagements.
Yeah, and I'll conclude. I would also be curious on what the satisfaction level is of those who go through the claims clinic process, 70% favorable, 80% favorable. You know, if you go to your local VA hospital, they get very high satisfactory rates versus the satisfaction rate of those who go through the traditional claims process. That seems to me to be a very relevant consideration moving forward. Thank you for your testimony and answering my questions. I'll yield back. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Costello. Ms. Bradley?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I just wanted to ask a few questions around Mr. Miller's bill with regards to reproductive assistance for service-connected disabled veterans. And Mr. McClenican, I think you said earlier that one of your objections is that all veterans should be treated the same. Is that correct?
Within that category of special monthly compensation, yes.
Okay. Well, my concern really related to this is I agree that every veteran should be treated the same, but not with regards to the upfront cost, but to regards to the outcomes, which in this case is having children, creating a family, that the outcomes should be the same, not the investment upfront to get to that end. And so that, you know, that certainly is a concern, certainly that I have. And I also wanted to ask you with regards to, I know the Department of Defense provides these services to our military men and women, and obviously they serve in our military, they leave the military, and then suddenly they receive their benefits from the VA, and they're not similar at all. In fact, right now, they're very, very different. One does and one doesn't. So I think Mr. Miller's bill, in terms of payment, is a step in the right direction, but I think we need to go further, and in terms of making sure that we have equal outcomes with regards to our men and women who have served, who are disabled, who want to have a family. I also, with regards to the funding, and maybe you can comment, but with regards to the lump sum payments of two $10,000 payments. If the VA was going to pursue this, do you think that that cost is, or that payment is enough to cover the cost?
Well, I don't have an opinion on whether the payment of this particular lump sum benefit serves the purpose that Chairman Miller had in mind. You know, I did mention that approximately 106,000 grants over a three-year, 106,000 grants over the last three fiscal years is what we'd be looking at here. And unfortunately, if you're asking about costs, you know, I apologize for not having the costs for some of these bills available for the hearing. We're going to follow up as soon as possible with a separate views letter on the costs. But roughly, I just wanted to give you an idea of those. That's about 106,000, 30-some thousand a year that these benefits would be going to. You know, one thing that the committee could look at is, rather than lump sums, whether there's some other fit within the current scheme of special monthly compensation that might be more appropriate. There are higher levels of special monthly compensation.
Well, again, I would be looking in terms of equity, in terms of outcome. It's my understanding that if one chooses to pursue IVF treatments, that can cost approximately $12,500 per treatment. Sometimes it's going to take two, three, four, five times as is typical. If there's sperm extraction, that can cost to $25,000 to $3,000. So I think, you know, to get to that outcome, it's going to require more. The other question I just wanted to ask is that in your testimony, you stated that a potential change that could be helpful for surviving spouses in lieu of the Love Lives On Act would be amending or eliminating 38 U.S.C. 5120. However, I'm having a hard time understanding how that would help surviving spouses who are interested in remarrying and retaining their pension benefits.
Thank you for that question, because we didn't intend a misunderstanding there. That would not be a helpful amendment or repeal. That was simply, our position is that is an obsolete provision that Congress should repeal. It has to do with postal workers reporting spouses that have remarried to the department. It's clearly an obsolete provision, and we have no objection to it being repealed.
Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you, Ms. Brownlee. Dr. Ruiz?
Thank you, Dr. Abraham. My questions have been asked, so I have no further questions.
Okay, well, I'm going to open a second round of questions just real quick. There's a couple things I want to get answered here. This goes back to you, Mr. McClendon. Why is the department opposing to paying DIC benefits to a surviving spouse who remarries prior to the age of 57?
So, Mr. Chairman, let me begin with this, that, you know, historically, going back a long time, the purpose of some of our survivor benefit programs is to take care of spouses who have lost the support of their spouse. And our programs have been very effective for that. I've administered those programs for about the last 5 years now. We take it very seriously. It would be a very substantial change. Given the current law, the current scheme that's in the law, and the exceptions that are provided, and those exceptions are, you know, if a spouse reaches age 57, the remarriage is not a bar. Also, if at any time a remarriage is terminated or annulled, becomes void, automatically the spouse becomes eligible again for DIC. So Congress constructed the current statutory framework to ensure that spouses do have the support they need if they do not remarry. This would be a dramatic shift away from that policy, and it would be an expensive change in policy, as well as burdening our current survivor benefit programs, which are very important that we process those quickly and get them to the spouses that need them.
Okay. All right, thank you. Mr. Hanan, how would reserving 1,000 grave sites, or even 100, for recipients of the Medal of Honor impact burial availability at Arlington National Cemetery for service members who are killed in action?
Mr. Chairman, it wouldn't have no immediate impact. We view the intent of the legislation is to protect those plots going into the future, so there is an availability. It would have no immediate impact. Our concern, as I raised in my testimony, is the broader issue, a more holistic approach as to keeping Arlington open and active in the out years.
Okay. Excuse me. Mr. Sullivan, under what circumstances does the department currently provide committal services on weekends?
Mr. Chairman, as a matter of policy, we provide commitments or interments on weekends for extraordinary reasons. Those could include potentially cultural or religious preferences. We do also provide weekend interments for service members killed in action. And as a matter of policy, we do not go more than 48 hours without providing burial services. So on three-day holiday weekends, we will ensure that we provide burial services on one of those weekend days.
Thank you. Ms. Titus?
Thank you very much. I'd just like to go back to the possibility of remarrying for surviving spouses. And I know they stood up earlier, but we didn't really give them their due. They made a real effort to come here today. And we often talk about the veteran's family and the sacrifices that they make and how extreme their sacrifices are, as well as those made by the veteran himself. And I'd just like to take a minute to say again, thank you all for your courage and for coming here to discuss what I think is a very important issue. And you heard the VA say we need to get rid of things that are antiquated. I certainly think this is antiquated, too. I mean, look at the veterans who are making the ultimate sacrifice, and you see how very young so many of them are, the majority. And so thank you again for coming. I just wonder if the VA would be supportive if resources were provided to cover these benefits, and also if you have looked at how the UK did it to see if there are any kind of parallels or why it would be so difficult for us to accommodate this when they were able to do that. Mr. McClunkin, could you address that?
Yes, Ranking Member Titus. I think you're aware that we're always interested in improving our benefit programs, and this is no exception. We're always looking for ways to improve the DIC program, the Survivor's Pension Program, burial benefit, monetary burial benefits. So we are not opposed at looking at ways to improve our program. So I hope, you know, that addresses your question, that if there was funding available for a particular program improvement, I'm sure the department would take that into consideration in its views for a bill.
Absolutely. I think we should look at how it's been done in other places, too, because I think that might provide some guidance or some encouragement that if they can do it, we can do it too. So let's look at that. Then one last thing, I just can't resist mentioning this. You said we should repeal, you mentioned a certain provision, we should repeal it because that language is really antiquated. And I think the VA would agree that we need to repeal the language that is equally antiquated that refers to a spouse as a member of the opposite sex, instead of realizing that this is not our grandfather's military or VA anymore, and that's an antiquated concept, not just in society, but in law and by the Supreme Court.
I believe the department has expressed its views in support of that bill in the past.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Titus. Ms. Brownlee?
Any more questions, except I just would like to also, as Ms. Titus did, say thank you to the spouses that are here in the audience and for their commitment and their courage and strength to be here with us all today. And I think that it is frustrating, I think, to hear from the VA, quite frankly, that the problem, with the Love Lives On Act is that it's just too cumbersome to really handle, that we should have an attitude of, this makes sense, let's see how we can move towards this goal, and let us know how much it's going to cost so that we can wrestle with that information and be able to assess our priorities, understanding that we can't pay for everything, but let us make those judgments and move forward. I yield back.
Thank you, Ms. Brownlee. Thanks again for the panel showing up. If there are no other questions, you are excused. And I now recognize our final panel of witnesses.
Just a second.
Yeah, I'm going to get them. We have today Mr. Carl Blake, the Associate Executive Director of Government Relations for the Paralyzed Veterans of America, Mr. Alex Borowski, the Deputy Director of the National Legislative Services at the Veterans of Foreign Wars of the United States, Mr. Paul R. Barilla, the Assistant National Legislative Director for Disabled American Veterans, Ms. Elizabeth Davis, who will discuss her experience with survivors' benefits, and Mr. Edward G. Lilly, the team leader for health policy of the National Veterans Affairs and Rehabilitation Division at the American Legion. Again, thank you for being here and for your hard work for the advocacy of our veteran heroes. Mr. Blake, we'll begin with you. Are you recognized for 5 minutes, sir?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Chairman Abraham, Ranking Member Titus, on behalf of Paralyzed Veterans of America. I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to testify today. You have my full written statement for the record, so I will limit my comments to the one bill on the agenda that has the greatest impact on PVA members. Since 2001, more than 1,400 service members have suffered specifically a genitourinary injury. Over that same time, thousands of veterans have suffered catastrophic TBI and spinal cord injury that have also precluded their ability to have children naturally. Unfortunately, the VA is limited, in some cases prohibited, from providing health and financial services that fully meet the needs of these veterans. When a veteran has a loss of reproductive ability due to a service-related injury, they bear the total cost to provide for their family and to create a family. It is often the case that veterans cannot afford these services and are not able to receive medical treatment necessary for them to conceive children. For many veterans, procreative services have been secured in the private sector at great personal and financial cost. Let me say that PVA does support H.R. 4892 as introduced that would pay special compensation to certain veterans with the loss or loss of use of creative organs. As stated, this bill would provide up to a total benefit of $20,000. Let me also say that we sincerely appreciate the work of both this subcommittee staff and the health subcommittee staff to find a workable solution to what is the real problem. But let me be clear. The legislation that was introduced serves as a means to an end, but it's not the right means to the right end. We believe there are two significant problems that remain with this bill, even if it is enacted. First and foremost, we believe that reproductive services should absolutely be part of the medical benefits package of the Department of Veterans Affairs. If this country is willing to send young men and women into harm's way who will suffer grievous injuries, then it is our responsibility to make them whole again. If that means losing the ability to have children, then it is incumbent upon this country to do what is necessary to restore that possibility. The proposed legislation seems to provide a way to get to that point, but it's working around what the actual issue is. Second flaw that we see with this legislation is the value of the benefit and the inequity it creates between men and women veterans. While the benefit seemingly affords catastrophically disabled veterans, most of whom are men, the opportunity to procure reproductive services, in particular IVF, which is the hot button issue, it does not address the financial burden for women who suffer a similar grievous injury. IVF on average costs about $10,000 for one round of treatments. So this bill would arguably provide for a couple of rounds of that. That would benefit primarily men who usually use that as a service option outside of the VA because it's not available if they choose to have children with their spouse. It's important to note that while the average cost of one treatment of course of IVF is approximately $10,000, the average cost of a domestic single-child adoption ranges anywhere from $15,000 to $40,000. Additionally, the cost of gestational surrogacy can range anywhere from $60,000 to $120,000. And those are the options that most often a woman veteran with a catastrophic injury that precludes their ability to have children has to rely upon. And so while this bill provides a meaningful step to afford the opportunity for these types of services, it doesn't come close to providing the option for women veterans who often experience this. I know the subcommittee recognizes this and this is a challenge, but it's something I think that needs to be considered if this bill is going to be moved forward. Again, let me reiterate that our priority is that reproductive services should be made a part of the medical benefits package. That is what is part of making whole the veteran who has sacrificed so much. There is not any other, that I'm aware of, particular injury that a service member can suffer while in service to this country that the VA doesn't both compensate and provide health care services in some setting to offset their loss. I recognize that this is a complicated issue. This is not a complicated issue for PVA and its members. We know what the right thing is to do. We hope Congress will see what the right thing is and act upon that as well. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll be happy to answer any questions that you have.
Thank you, Mr. Blake. Mr. Morawski, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Titus, and members of the subcommittee. On behalf of the Veterans of Foreign Wars of the United States, I'd like to thank you for the opportunity to offer our thoughts on today's pending legislation. The bills we're discussing today are intended to improve many of the benefits that veterans need and deserve, and we thank you for bringing them forward. Mr. Chairman, the VFW supports the Final Farewell Act, which would allow VA to permit weekend burials at national cemeteries when requested by the veteran's family for religious or cultural reasons. We believe this is a perfectly reasonable accommodation. The VFW supports H.R. 3936, the VET Act, which would establish a 3-year pilot program to carry out veteran engagement team events at 10 locations nationwide to adjudicate veterans' disability claims on the spot. Our VFW service officers have witnessed similar claims clinics already being held in select locations and have reported on how successful they can be. In one extreme case, a homeless female veteran from Winston-Salem, North Carolina, whose claim was stalled in the local appeal process, was able to produce the piece of evidence she needed to grant, resulting in a retroactive payment of over $100,000. Our only suggestion for the bill would be to also hold the events on weekends as well as normal business hours, as many veterans who work full-time would likely be unable to attend during a work week. The VFW supports the Fair Treatment for Families of Veterans Act, which would grant payments through the end of the month when VA benefit is discontinued due to death or marriage. We believe this is the right thing to do so as not to burden grieving families with unnecessary debt due to unforeseen overpayments. VFW supports H.R. 4757, requiring VA to furnish to the survivors of any deceased Medal of Honor recipient a headstone, marker, or medallion signifying that veteran's status as a Medal of Honor recipient. VFW fully supports this, as the final resting places of those who receive our nation's highest award for valor should be granted special recognition. The VFW also supports H.R. 4758, which would authorize the award of the Presidential Memorial Certificate to members of the Guard and Reserve, as well as ROTC candidates who die in the line of duty. Likewise, we support H.R. 4759, which authorizes VA to cover transportation costs for veterans interred in state and tribal cemeteries, similar to veterans interred at VA national cemeteries. We support the Veterans COLA Act of 2016, which increases VA compensation and other benefits, providing cost of living adjustment beginning December 1 of this year. However, we continue to oppose the rounding down of the COLA increase, as we believe this is a money-saving device that comes at the expense of veterans and their survivors. The VFW supports a draft bill to grant two payments of $10,000 as special compensation to veterans who have lost or lost the use of their reproductive organs as a result of their military service. Due to widespread use of improvised explosive devices in the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan, both male and female service members have suffered from spinal cord and reproductive injuries. Many of these veterans hope to one day start families, but their injuries prevent them from conceiving. The funds provided by this bill could be used for adoption or other expenses. And we see this bill as an excellent complement to H.R. 2257 and H.R. 3365, which would expand VA fertility treatment options for veterans who have suffered similar injuries. VFW supports the draft bill to improve the consideration of evidence by the Board of Veterans' Appeals. Under this bill, additional evidence received after submission of the Form 9 would be subject to initial review by the Board by default. Veterans may still elect to have evidence reviewed by the AOJ. This is important, as some veterans may feel confident that the additional evidence they are submitting will allow the AOJ to grant their claims in full without the need to wait for their appeals to reach the board. The VFW further supports the provision of the bill that would require additional evidence to be reviewed by the AOJ within 180 days when the veteran makes that election. We also support the intent of requiring the AOJ to certify the appeal within 180 days after the review is completed, but would suggest that that time frame be shortened to perhaps 60 days. In our view, one of the log jams in the appeal process is that the AOJs take far too long to certify appeals once their work is completed. Lastly, we suggest a minor technical change to subsection A2B of section 1 by inserting at the beginning, if such review does not result in a fully favorable decision. The VFW supports the draft bill to reserve 1,000 burial plots at Arlington National Cemetery for individuals who have been awarded the Medal of Honor. 77 living Medal of Honor recipients and those who may be awarded our nation's highest award for valor in the future should be granted a final resting place in our nation's most hallowed burial ground. And finally, the VFW supports the Love Lives On Act, which would allow surviving spouses who remarry to continue receiving VA survivor benefits. We believe that surviving spouses, many of whom are young, should not have to endure a life of loneliness just so they can continue to receive the benefits granted to them through the death of their spouses. Mr. Chairman, this concludes my statement, and I'm happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you, Mr. Morawski. Mr. Varela, 5 minutes, sir.
Dr. Abraham, Ranking Member Titus, and members of the subcommittee, good morning. On behalf of DAV, thank you for the opportunity to discuss the merits of the bills before us today. I will focus my comments this morning on two pieces of pending legislation and two bills in draft form that are of particular interest to our organization. First, H.R. 3936, the Veteran Engagement Teams Act, or VETACT. This bill would require VA's secretary to carry out a 3-year pilot program facilitating VET events in order to complete on-site processing of claims for disability compensation and pension. DAV supports the VETACT in accordance with our national resolution 001 that calls for enhanced outreach to ensure that all wounded, ill, and injured veterans receive all benefits they have earned. We are pleased to support this bill and look forward to working together towards its enactment. Second, H.R. 4782, the Veterans Compensation Cost of Living Adjustment, COLA Act of 2016. This bill would increase the rates of disability compensation, clothing allowance, and dependency indemnity compensation, effective on December 1st, 2016. Consistent with DAV Resolution 013, which calls on Congress to support legislation to provide a realistic increase in disability compensation, we support this bill. While Congress has customarily determined a COLA in parity with Social Security recipients, it is important to note there have been several years in which Social Security recipients did not receive a COLA, as was the case this year.
Likewise, beneficiaries in receipt of VA compensation and survivor benefits did not receive a COLA. Furthermore, DAV believes Congress should consider a better formula to compensate service-connected veterans, their survivors, and dependents for wounds, injuries, and illnesses sustained during military service. DAV members passed resolution number 059, which calls on Congress to support the enactment of legislation to provide a realistic increase in VA compensation rates to bring the standard of living of disabled veterans in line with that which they would have otherwise enjoyed had they not suffered their service-connected disabilities. DAV has always supported legislation that provides veterans with a COLA. DAV is adamantly opposed to the practice of rounding down COLAs to the nearest whole dollar amount, and we oppose the round-down feature in this bill based on DAV Resolution 017. Third, the discussion draft for Special Monthly Compensation, SMCU. If enacted, the legislation would pay SMCU to veterans entitled to receive SMCK due to the loss of or loss of use of creative organs. Seemingly, this bill contemplates one possible option to provide some assistance in the form of compensation to overcome reproductive challenges associated with service-connected disabilities. DAV does not view this proposal as a comprehensive measure to solve this problem, as these veterans may require additional services beyond what the two $10,000 payments would cover. More must be done to ensure that veterans stricken with wounds, illnesses, and injuries that impede upon their natural ability to procreate receive, to the maximum extent possible, the full complement of services and benefits required to achieve a desired outcome. DAV does not have a resolution from its members pertaining to lump sum payments for the loss or loss of use of creative organs, but would not oppose passage of this legislation. However, if legislation were to be enacted to provide for these lump sum payments, it should not be used to supplement or offset other forms of payments or services that would aid these veterans in their procreative and adoptive pursuits. Finally, Mr. Chairman, the evidence development discussion draft. If enacted, the legislation would affect consideration of evidence before the Agency of Original Jurisdiction, AOJ, and the Board of Veterans Appeals Board. DAV opposes this legislation as it would create artificial suspense dates, limits an appellate's opportunity request for AOJ review of evidence, unnecessarily routes uninvestigated appeals directly to the board, attaches finality due to a board's decision on evidence reviewed in the first instance, and does not address how appellants would be made aware of their evidence review options. Simply closing the record or limiting AOJ review of evidence with the intention of getting the information before the board in the first instance has several inherent consequences as described in greater detail within our written testimony. Because of the potential detrimental effects on the due process rights of veterans, DAV would be opposed to this legislation if it were to be enacted. For the remaining bills, please see our written testimony for our comments and organization's positions. Dr. Abraham, Ranking Member Titus, and members of the subcommittee, I look forward to your questions today, and thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rivera. Ms. Davis, you're recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you. I'd like to take a moment and thank Chairman Abraham and Ranking Member Titus for this opportunity to testify on behalf of the Love Lives On Act for our military surviving spouse community. With me in attendance today are several of the widows of our nation's heroes. Although I will only be speaking about my own personal experience, each of these individuals has a heartbreaking story of sacrifice for our nation. My name is Elizabeth Davis, and I'm a 29-year-old mother, nurse, and widow to my Marine. My husband, First Lieutenant Matthew Davis, was killed on 7 November 2014. While Matt was serving as officer of the day on regimental duty, he was struck and killed by a fellow 2-5 Marine who was drunk driving and evading the police. Matt was a selfless, gregarious giant of a man with a sense of humor as big as he was. Nothing will ever change my feelings for him, even though I know he will not be coming back. The night I found out he was killed, I actually had a heart attack when our best friend showed up in his dress blues to deliver the news in the early hours of the morning. I quite literally will bear the scars on my heart from this news for the rest of my life. After recovering from the shock of being widowed, I decided I was going to honor my husband by devoting my time and energy into making this rough journey easier in any way possible for other military widows. I started looking for ways to help widows provide for themselves and their families when I moved back to Virginia. The first step was to ensure that Virginia accepted the Department of Defense's definition of Gold Star spouse, making sure that we honored the sacrifices of those killed in the line of duty, as well as those killed in action. With the help of my delegate, House Bill 98 was introduced and passed through the Virginia House of Delegates and Senate. Recently, I was granted the opportunity to discuss with the Commandant in the Marine Corps, General Neller, how the culture of alcohol in the Marine Corps has impacted my family. I've also remained active in the Stafford County Armed Services Memorial Committee. My long-term goal is to ensure that our widowed community, which has already given so much for this great nation, faces no additional or unnecessary hardship. The next step, which I pray you will support, is to improve the lives of this very small but very important community. We are seeking repeal and amendment to the age stipulation through the Love Lives On Act. Currently, as the widow of a fallen service member, you may remarry and retain your benefits after the age of 57. With the vast majority of our heroes being young and leaving behind spouses who are equally young, it is unreasonable to expect the surviving spouse not to seek out happiness and love again well before he or she is 57. As it currently stands, I and the other survivors in this room have no incentive to move on with our lives and rebuild our families. Rather, we are strongly bound to remain single parents with the incomplete families in order to retain benefits that our husbands earned by dying for this country. The full impact of the current limitations is felt not only by the surviving spouse, but also by the children of our fallen. These benefits have been earned at the cost of loss of life for country and are necessary in maintaining the needs of the spouse and all of the surviving children. This program is vital because it provides the ability to have a safe home and food on plate for the families who are left behind. In almost every case of a widower or widow, our nation puts the draconian decision to choose to seek love again over being pragmatic with our finances. This choice is ultimately made for us, hindering the very freedoms our spouses gave their lives for under the current guidelines. Why would anyone in this room choose to remarry when we can receive these benefits but date a new person in perpetuity? Amending the statute would cement the belief in our service members that the United States cares what happens to them as individuals. Not only is the sacrifice and commitment that they made in dying for our country forever, but so too is the commitment of the United States to their families should they perish. The risks and lifestyles associated with our nation's military can be unpredictable, but providing benefits for those left behind should not be. We should not be punished for seeking out love and happiness that our spouses would want us to have. As a spouse, we deserve to try and heal and be happy, and for the children left behind, they deserve a stable, loving home where both of their parents are legally recognized as a family unit without repercussion of the loss of necessary income. Through your vote, you can make a positive change for the families of our fallen heroes. By continuing to provide benefits to surviving spouses, families will heal and produce children that will grow up knowing that service has meaning. For us as widows, life truly is too short. We fully grasp that concept often in our 20s and 30s, when our peers won't have to face these kind of hardships for decades. Please enable us to have a choice in marriage before the age of 57. The widows and children of the fallen were handed a folded flag on behalf of a grateful nation. In that short moment upon handing the flag over, there is no if or but when it comes to the commitment our husband showed this great nation. I have the utmost faith that the men and women in this room will do their best to honor that oath paid for in blood well before we are 57.
Thank you, Ms. Davis. There are simply no words to express what I know you and the ones behind you and the thousands across the nation in your shoes, unfortunately, are feeling, but thank you for your service and those behind you for your service to this country, certainly your fallen heroes that you no longer have. Mr. Lilly, you're recognized for the American Legion for 5 minutes.
Thank you, and good morning, Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member Titus, and members of the committee. On behalf of National Commander Dale Barnett and the over 2 million members of the American Legion, we are pleased to offer remarks regarding pending legislation. The slate of bills covers a wide range of topics and proof that the impact of the Department of Veterans Affairs and its benefits are due to the wide-ranging needs of veterans community, many of whom have physical and emotional scars related to their service in the armed forces. There are several good bills up for discussion today, and you have my full written remarks, but in the interest of time, I would like to focus on 4 key bills. First, I'd like to start talking about the VET Act. In response to a national crisis, the American Legion immediately went to work in communities throughout the country, meeting with veterans face-to-face one at a time. American Legion began setting up Veterans Benefit Centers, or VBCs, throughout the country by collaborating with VA staff, American Red Cross volunteers, and other community partners to staff over a dozen VBCs across the country within the first 9 months of the Phoenix scandal. During these VBCs, we were able to assist more than 3,000 veterans and their families with scheduling outpatient appointments, enrolling in the VA healthcare system, and applying for compensation, pension, disability indemnity compensation benefits, and other services veterans and their families needed assistance with. I would like to share two success stories on how veterans' lives have been impacted by our VBCs. A homeless veteran who came to the Fayetteville, North Carolina VBC looking for assistance stated, "I didn't have a lot of faith in what was going on, but someone did help me out, and I want you all to know that in my bank account this morning was my $11,000 retro check. I can now move me and my son out of my vehicle, and I can buy my son a healthy meal." A veteran from Texas stated, "I had an appointment that was 120 days down the road with my primary doctor. They took care of it and moved it up a month and a half." The VBCs work in the same manner as this bill, putting all the players in the community together to get the help to the veterans. This bill would help veterans receive the benefits they have earned by addressing the barriers between VA and the veterans they serve within the community. Therefore, the American Legion supports the VET Act. The Medal of Honor is the United States of America's highest military honor awarded for personal acts of valor above and beyond the call of duty. The intent of the next two bills is to expand benefits to Medal of Honor recipients. H.R. 4757 would direct the VA to furnish at a private cemetery a headstone, marker, or medallion that signifies the status of an eligible veteran as a Medal of Honor recipient. The Medal of Honor Legacy Act would hold 1,000 of the remaining 60,000 burial plots at Arlington National Cemetery to be exclusively assigned to Medal of Honor recipients should they choose to be buried there. This would allow those who have received the highest military honor to continue to have a place at the nation's most hallowed burial place. By resolution, the American Legion supports any legislation that would expand the benefits to Medal of Honor recipients. Finally, I would like to discuss the Compensation Cost of Living Adjustment Act of 2016, or COLA. This bill allows for a COLA for VA disability benefits. However, within Section 2 of this bill, it is noted that each dollar amount increased under Paragraph 1, if not a whole dollar, shall be rounded to the next lower whole dollar amount. In order for American Legion to support this bill, we ask Congress to remove Section 2 and allow veterans to receive the full benefits awarded due to their service without rounding down. Again, on behalf of National Commander Dale Barnett and the members that comprise this nation's largest wartime veteran service organization, we appreciate the opportunity to speak for you this morning to discuss these bills that could have long-lasting effects upon the veteran community. I'll be happy to answer any questions the committee may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lillian. Thank you all for your testimony. I'll start with some questions, and this is for everyone on the panel. Based on your organization's experience, how would veterans and their families benefit, assuming that they receive the COLA next year? Mr. Blake?
Well, that's assuming there's going to be a COLA, particularly this year when we had 0%. I mean, I think it's well-established fact that the cost of living doesn't go down year after year, despite what the COLA statistics suggest. It impacts your ability to pay their bills, provide for their families. I mean, we're talking about not necessarily significant amounts, but it plays into the way that many families budget for their daily living. Without the COLA, that has an impact.
I concur with that, Mr. Chairman. In addition, this year where there wasn't a COLA, we received a lot of calls from our members talking about how they feel as though cost of living has gone up, food gets more expensive, housing costs have gotten more expensive. Having looked into it, you see that the reason why the CPI stayed flat was because gasoline prices fell so much. But as been pointed out by others, some people who are severely disabled or elderly people may not necessarily benefit as much from falling gasoline prices, but they certainly feel the raising medical costs, the raising housing costs, and the raising food costs. So a cost of living increase is critically important.
Thank you. Mr. Varela.
Thank you, Dr. Abraham. I would align our comments with that of PVA and VFW, but also add what the representative from American Legion stated about eliminating the round down provision, which I think is particularly important this year if we're able to get a COLA passed, seeing as one was not passed this year. And also, we want veterans who are receiving disability compensation to be able to meet a basic standard of living, and we continue to erode the potency of their disability compensation as it pertains to their ability to maintain that standard of living.
Ms. Davis, you have a comment?
No, sir, I do not. Survivors do not receive a COLA.
I understand.
Mr. Chairman, for these veterans and their family members, COLA is not simply an acronym or minor adjustment in benefits. Instead, it is a tangible benefit that meets the needs of the increasing costs of living in a nation that they have bravely defended. By resolution, the American Legion supports any legislation to provide a periodic cost of living adjustment increase and to increase the monthly rates of disability compensation. So we agree that it is an important benefit that needs to be increased.
All right, thank you all. Mr. Varela, this is for you, I guess. So why do you believe that the current rate on special monthly compensation is not is not sufficient for veterans who have received a catastrophic injury to their creative organs?
If I'm not mistaken, the rate that is paid for SMCK is roughly $100 a month. I don't know that that's enough to help somebody procreate. It's not enough to help somebody procreate, and it wouldn't be enough to help with adoptive services. So there has to be something else in place to help overcome that barrier where that special monthly compensation doesn't really achieve the particular outcome.
Okay. Mr. Lilly, the next question is for you. You indicate that you support the draft legislation on development of evidence. How do you think this proposed change would expedite the appeals process?
So, Mr. Chairman, we have seen proof. So VA issued FAST letters 1321 and 1402 in 2013 and 2014, respectively, that directed its employees to proceed in the manner directed by the draft legislation. In July of 2015, the VA included language from the FAST letters in M21-1. While preparing for this testimony, American Legion contacted one of our seasoned accredited representatives in Detroit, and he couldn't have been more empathetic and supportive of the results of the FAST letters. Instead of veterans waiting for nearly a year to have supplemental statement of the case, or SSOC, the case could be forwarded to the certified by the BVA. American Legion is supportive of the VA having efficient manners to adjudicate claims and appeals through eliminating the requirement of an SSOC, and veterans are not being punished for submitting evidence following the filing of the substantial appeal.
All right, thank you, Mr. Lilly. Mr. Murawski, please elaborate on what you believe that the families of the Reserve and the National Guard service members should be able to receive a presidential memorial certificate commemorating their service to the country.
Well, quite simply, Mr. Chairman, these are service members who have died in the line of duty. We already grant it to active duty service members who die in the line of duty. We feel as though members of the Guard and Reserve, as well as ROTC cadets who die training in the line of duty, their families are equally deserving of that recognition.
Okay. Thank you. I'm out of time. Ms. Ranking Member Titus.
Thank you very much. I appreciate, Mr. Blake, you mentioning how this whole compensation for loss of creative organs also affects women, but it would be very nice to have some women veterans at the table talking about it themselves. So I hope as this moves forward, we have those representatives here to help us to structure this in a way that will truly be helpful. It seems to me that somebody sometime made an arbitrary decision that an organ is worth a certain amount. You lose an arm, you get a certain amount. You lose an eye, you get a certain amount. You lose the ability to have children, you get a certain amount. So we're saying that the inability to have children is worth $100 a month. Is that kind of how it works, Mr. Blake, or anybody?
I guess, theoretically speaking, that's probably true.
Do you think it's worth more than that?
Well, in my opinion, it's priceless.
Exactly. Exactly. Thank you very much for saying that. That says it all. But I would ask one specific question about the bill that's before us that has to do with this issue, which I agree with what many of you said is not the way to go about addressing it, and it's just kind of half-assed, actually. Under this bill where you get a lump sum to pay for adoption, I don't believe there's anything in the bill, and correct me if I'm wrong, that says you have to be married to get this to adopt, use this money for adoption. And also, you could be a gay couple and use this money for adoption. Is that accurate?
I don't think it makes any particular distinction. I think you're eligible for the benefit. The veteran is eligible for the benefit. The relationship they're in is not contemplated in the context of the legislation.
Okay. Thank you very much. I yield back.
Thank you, Ms. Titus. Ms. Brownlee.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you, Ms. Davis, for your testimony, particularly today. And we appreciate, we're deeply sorry and appreciate your husband's service to our country, and certainly your service to our country as well, because we all know here that it takes really takes a whole family to support the man or woman who is on the battlefield. So thank you very much for that, and to all of the other spouses that are here today standing with you on this really important issue. I just think it, you know, when we're talking about benefits to surviving spouses, when someone dies in a family, I think everyone, their wishes for the surviving spouse, particularly in this case for the surviving family members, is that they want to be first make sure that their family is taken care of, and secondly, to wish them, you know, happiness in their future life. And I think this is a really important bill to try to meet those, meet that criteria, if you will. And, you know, when someone who has served our country and served our country so bravely, we need to make sure that if they die, that we are taking care of them, and they don't have to worry about their family once they are deceased. That they need to know unequivocally that we are going to take care of their family. And so it is, I think this bill is extremely, extremely important to make sure that we're taking care of the family and wishing the spouse a quality of life and happiness in his or her life, without question. And I guess, Ms. Davis, I would just ask the question to you, based on your conversations and your advocacy with a widowed community within the military, do you have relationships with people who have absolutely postponed their happiness and their pursuit of happiness because they have to be 57 years or older?
Absolutely. Particularly when there are children involved, that monthly benefit is mandatory to just keep the household running and all of our basic necessities. We're punished if we do get married. We're punished at a certain age if we don't get married. We're punished with some of our benefits if we choose to work. So we're kind of stuck in this catch-22 where we have to postpone our lives. It's not really a choice that we get to make. And it's extremely unfortunate that we have these heroes who we're so proud of, who have defended all these freedoms for everybody else, but nobody's looking out for our freedoms. And that's not okay. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, yes, thank you. And I think, you know, another point that I would just make on this particular issue, when we're talking about our younger men and women, surviving spouses who are younger, if they choose to work, they're very early in their career. And we know as we climb the career ladder, we tend to make more as we pursue that career year after year after year. So logic says when you're young and early, you might just be beginning that process, and that compensation becomes even more important for our younger spouses than those who might have been, may have been, working in their careers, and as they reach an earlier age, might be yielding, you know, a more significant income. Doesn't apply to everyone, but it could apply to some. So, anyway, I just want to thank you again, you know, for your courage to be here, and for the other surviving spouses who are here. Thank you for being here. Thank you for your testimony, and thank you for your advocacy, and and we hope very much that we can succeed in this endeavor. The last question that I would just ask very quickly of the American Legion is that I noticed that you didn't make a comment or don't have a recommendation on Mr. Miller's reproductive assistance bill, and if you have an opinion specifically on the bill.
Thank you, Congresswoman. We're very excited about the effort to try and make veterans with service-connected injuries whole again. We fully support parity between the authorized services offered to DOD active duty members and the veterans who have since left DOD with the exact same complications. We do have some concerns over the language that we believe would be easy to overcome, and we look forward to working with the congressional staff to work through these concerns.
Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you, Ms. Brownlee. There are no further questions. This panel is excused. I want to thank everybody for coming here today and sharing your views on these 11 bills. Ms. Davis, again, thank you and those behind you for your journey. I will tell you that my bill, co-sponsored by Ms. Titus, does have COLA increases for DIC benefits, so maybe a little ray of sunshine there. I ask unanimous consent that written statement provided by the Vietnam's Veterans of America be placed in the hearing record. Without objection, so ordered. Finally, I ask unanimous consent that all members have 5 legislative days to revise and extend their remarks and include extraneous material on any of these bills under consideration this afternoon. Without objection, so ordered. This hearing is now adjourned.